people spend their whole lives climbing. Maybe a ladder of success, or a ladder of popularity, a ladder of acceptance, a ladder of survival, depending on what they've been through, a ladder of financial freedom, right? Or a ladder of one accomplishment or another. That they climb toward maybe more knowledge, or even a ladder leading to higher and better religious experiences. We spend our whole lives going after something, whether we even realize it or not. Sometimes it's very deliberate and intentional, and sometimes what we're chasing can be subconscious, but we're all chasing something. It's what keeps us going, it seems. I mean, isn't that why we wake up in the morning? To get a little closer to the goal, to get to the top, to check off the next item on the to-do list? Problem is many people get closer to the top or the end of the ladder that they've been climbing, or as we check off those last few boxes, one day something happens to each and every one of us. Maybe we reach another milestone, tick another box, and we stop to celebrate. Or maybe we run into a missing rung on life's ladder, an insurmountable and even unfair problem. Sometimes people are pushed down off their ladder. But eventually, all of us stop. All of us pause, either out of a willful decision or against our will and out of necessity. But eventually, every one of us, we all pause. And at that moment, any of us can discover that our ladder has been leaning up against the wrong wall all along. Sometimes it happens after open heart surgery or that near-death experience. Sometimes we pause after the accident, or the diagnosis, or the curveball that our spouse throws our way, or the surprise our investments send us, or the new information that our kids announce. But we all pause eventually. And sometimes, right then and there, we discover that what we thought we wanted most, what we were climbing toward, whether or not it's been accomplished, in that pause, we see the emptiness. Sometimes we even see we're empty. It's in that pause, that break, that stop, that we realize life is not fair. Good or bad, life's not fair. Plans don't always produce results, because our plan, or in spite of our plan, regardless, plans don't always go the way we think they should. Our best laid plans are but wishes and wants if they're not in God's will. And the third thing we often discover is nothing is free. Everything costs something. And we all must pay the piper, one way or the other. It's in this pause, when we're making these discoveries, when we're thinking about the big questions of life, that we can look around and we can feel incredibly empty inside. And what's most scary and upsetting is this can all happen even though you may have achieved exactly or more than what you set out to accomplish in this life. See, many goals reveal the very emptiness inside of them only as you are about to reach them. It's one thing to have a little buyer's remorse over a new gadget or a toy or a purchase of some sort. You know, you dreamed of having this shiny new thing, whatever it might be, yet shortly after acquiring it, we've all been there, it wasn't all you dreamed it would be, right? Well, that's not the end of the world with a purchase at the dollar store. But nothing can be more sad at the end of a lifetime. The author of Ecclesiastes captures this feeling perfectly when he writes, "Meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless." King Solomon, he had it all. Wealth beyond measure, the Bible says. Wisdom beyond anyone else, women by the hundreds, palaces and gardens that were the envy of kings and kingdoms. He had the best food and the best wine and every form of entertainment available. In the standards of his day and even in ours, he had it all. Yet, he writes such sad words. But if we keep reading, we find something incredible. We find something life-giving and purpose-driving. Listen, when we discover the why to our lives, we can endure almost any how. When we lean our ladder up against the right place, we climb with purpose that never runs out. How we have to live, or what we need to do to survive, well, it's all possible, and we can endure almost anything when we understand the why, the reason, the purpose, not for our circumstances, but for our lives. Understand the why to your circumstances will never ever wipe away the tears, the pain. That there just isn't a good enough reason for some of the pain we go through. But understand the why to your life, not just your circumstances, well, that gets you through the worst and even the best circumstances. See, when we understand the why we're here, our will to fulfill the why becomes so much greater than anything we could ever have to endure. The pain of life, or even the excesses of success. You've heard the harrowing stories of those who survived the Holocaust, those who have endured terrible loss and tragedy, those who make it through and courageously confront their abusers. In the face of horrific pain, overwhelming loss, and everything seemingly going against them, some people come out on the other side not as mere survivors, but truly thriving. On the other hand, some celebrities have it all and yet don't allow that excess, that having it all, that abundance, to leave them empty the way it leaves others. They instead find their purpose and their meaning that lasts. See, those who survive, those who don't let their circumstances destroy them, have a greater understanding of their why, their purpose for living. Hey, it's week 5 of our If Only series. And it's the final week, and in just a few minutes, I want to lead you through a simple process for purpose to help you find your individual, specific purpose. Regardless of your age or stage of life, you'll be better off if only you understood your real purpose for living. Well, a life lived as though all there is to life is what we can see and experience with our senses is meaningless. We're all put on this planet, created for more than what we can experience in the here and now. King Solomon said, "Eternity is written on our hearts." We all know deep down there must be something more. And so we look, we search, we chase, we climb toward what we think will give life meaning and real purpose. In and of ourselves and with only our own ideas, we miss the mark every time. The truth is, we were designed by God to glorify God. Yet we're so separated from God by going our own way instead of His way. And so God makes the way for us to restore our separation from Him, simply calling upon the name of the Lord, the Bible says, confessing our way is wrong, we receive Christ as our Savior, and we end up adopted into the family of God, what the Bible calls being born again. As believers, and honestly, even as humans, whether we believe it or like it or not, That the only purpose that really matters and the only purpose that will truly satisfy is this built-in purpose to glorify God. However, let's be honest, without unpacking that phrase, to glorify God with our lives, it just seems like it's a pat answer, like we're supposed to somehow swallow a communion table and live to some kind of holy standard that most of us are a little afraid, rightly so, that we could never do. So what does it mean? And what does it really look like to glorify God and to serve Him with this as our life purpose? You might be surprised to learn that although we have the same ultimate life purpose in the big picture, to glorify God, how that looks for each of us is very different and very specific. If you think about it, with my gifts, with my abilities, with my strengths, and with all of my weaknesses, my background and my experiences, I mean, how I glorify God and how you will glorify God really would look completely different, wouldn't it? There is a proven, tried and true process that I've used to find real purpose, or specifically how to personalize my purpose and yours. And the first step to start us off with is by understanding who you really are. See, I am a husband, a father. I am a pastor, your pastor. I'm a man, I'm a Jeep driver, I'm a lover of Estes Fish and Chips. I am Kevin Matthews. And inside that name is a complicated identity that includes all of the aforementioned titles, but so much more. And it goes so much deeper than anything I could say on the surface here today. Understanding who you really are, or finding your true identity, well, that sounds simple, but let me caution you, who you really are, well, it's not who you might feel you are, who our culture says you are, or even who your mother says you are. You are first and foremost who God says you are. And if you get this foundational truth wrong, you will find one day, I promise, that your ladder was either up against the wrong wall or you've been climbing the wrong ladder all along. Our culture has a lot of people fooled into living their true identity, which would be great if people would live like the people God created them to be rather than living their own truth, or the identity that culture has assigned to them, the identity that culture says is good or will satisfy. See, if you're looking for purpose, the first thing you need to understand is who you really are, who God says you are. And so if you're not sure about that, before you go any further, I've got an email ready to send you to help you discover who God says you really are. You just go ahead and you send me a note or you give us a call. I want to get that into your hands, because first and foremost, we got to get the identity right. And so let's go ahead and let's get through this purpose process and even get it down in writing. If you want to take your phone or if you want to take some notes here, I'd love that. I think this will really help you, because we want to make this firm. We want to make it foundational to how you'll glorify God. And it starts, as I've said, with your identity. Number one, I am. Well, for me, that's Kevin Matthews, and I have a deep understanding of who I am in Christ. It's this identity that helps me know my ladder is firmly planted, and at least the bottom is planted on a firm foundation. But then the next step is, not only do we need to discover our identity, but we need to begin fleshing out this purpose. And the next thing to decide is, well, who's most important to me? Who do I want to do life with or even for? remembering that we serve God best when we serve others. See, we're already glorifying God. That's the big picture. But then it's our identity. And then second is, who is it do I want to do life with, that I want to make a difference in, that I want to help? Last week, we looked at relationships and friendships. And we said we were designed for connection, for community, for relationship. And your purpose needs to include others. And so step two in this purpose process is deciding who is most important to you. Listen, you cannot be everything to everyone, but you better be something to someone. Number three, the third in the purpose process is, what action do I want to help others take? Considering my unique gifts, abilities, my position, my relationships in life, the things I like, my education, whatever it is that has been poured into you, what can I help those who are most important to me do or understand? And then the fourth part of this process is, why? I mean, what's the so that? Why am I doing what I'm doing? What's the so that really matters, or the change or transformation that you want to help others make, to inspire in them, to equip them for, that really, really matters? I mean, to help you see what this all really looks like, for me personally, I might say I am a husband or father on a personal level. But more professionally, or as your pastor, I would say in my calling, I am Kevin Matthews. Or some might say in my position, I am a pastor. And then second, well, who's important? Well, for me as a pastor, I would describe the people that I believe I'm supposed to make a difference in as people who are either far from God, disinterested in God, or at least open to God, right? The question for you to ask is, who is it in my life that I'm going to focus on? Because just to cut to the chase, it doesn't satisfy to focus on yourself. Third, as we keep going, it's the action I want to help others actually take, the difference that I want to make in them. For me, it's, I want to help them connect with God in a real, authentic relationship. And then fourth, so that they can experience the life-changing purpose that I have. I mean, there's kind of my purpose. As a church, our life purpose, or our purpose for being, actually follows much the same template. Instead of I am, collectively, we would say we are the Point Church. And we help who? Well, we're helping, or as we like to say it like this, we're building people. All people, right? We're an inclusive church, and our goal or our purpose is to reach all people. And what do? Well, we're building people by helping them take their next step. So that, or why? Well, why are we doing what we're doing? Well, we're helping them reach their full God-given potential. So the church has this clear purpose. And when times are tough in the church, or there's things going on, or things just don't make any sense anymore, or we're questioning things and problems arise, our purpose becomes even more important. The same thing for me personally in my life. When I win or when I lose at life, it's then that my purpose needs to overpower whatever current position I find myself in. I can do that when I remember my identity in Christ, who I really am and who I feel I am at any given moment. Never matters nearly as much. And then remember who is most important to me. It's not my boss or someone who hurled an insult my way. No, for me, it's God first, family second, and then others that I want to help. For some people, their focus is on a very few. For others, it might be many that we're trying to influence. But it's got to be more than just me. When I think of what action I want to take to help others who are important to me, and the why I want to influence others, it's right there where my purpose overpowers the current position I find myself in. For you to truly have lasting happiness, meaning, and real purpose, well, your life purpose, your ladder needs firmly planted and leaning on God. After all, we were created to glorify God. And how that looks for you is found in exploring the four steps of the purpose process that I've laid out for you today. Find your identity. I am. Finish that sentence. And then the second step is to decide your people. I mean, decide who is most important to you. I am Kevin Matthews, and I am here to help my kids, or change my family, or encourage my coworkers, or I'm focused on people who eat potatoes. Whatever your group might be, whatever people you feel called to. That's the next part. And then the third is choose your activity to take their next step. And then fourth and finally, plan the transformation, the change that you want to bring about in others that will ultimately also transform your own life. Listen to me. You were built for purpose. And your purpose is to glorify God. When you glorify God in the unique ways that He put within you, you discover that you can get through any circumstance because you begin to see the purpose in the pain, or the purpose in your position in life. I wish I could tell you something different, but we all will have trouble in this life. Pain and suffering is the price of admission to this planet, I'm afraid. It's just part of life, and the last thing you want is to have the goals of a dead person, and it's only dead people who have no pain, no trouble, no problems. To get you through the pain, the problems, the troubles of this life, lean your ladder against the right wall. Lean on Jesus. Accept the identity that He has for you. Embrace it, believe it, receive it, understand it. Set out to do life with people, the right people, and for people. Help them to do something that will bring about their transformation. And in the process, you'll not only find purpose, you yourself will be transformed. If you understood what I just taught, it's not too early and it's not too late. Instead of saying, if only I had real purpose, if only I had have started sooner, if only it wasn't so late, if only I wasn't so young, before you find yourself in the unexpected or unplanned pause of life, will you join with me now in a planned pause? Join with me in declaring, I am on purpose. Father God, as we bow before you, every person that can hear my voice right now, God, we just bow in the presence of the Almighty. And first and foremost, God, we just ask in the name of Jesus that you would reveal to us how you see us. God, quiet the voices of the culture, quiet the voices of who has said what or our feelings. And in this moment, Lord Jesus, remind us of who we are in Christ Jesus. Then, Father God, I pray that you would help us to be outward focused. Help us to decide who it is that we want to impact, that we want to influence, that we want to help. And then what it is that we ought to do to help those people so that they might have the kind of transformation that you put us here on this planet for. God, as we help others, may you just firmly help us to see the purpose that you've put us here for. In Jesus' name, amen.